Everybody knows about it, you know, every gay youth knows about the Stonewall and the Stonewall riots, you know, you have to know your history, girl.
I mean, not every gay youth does, so you want to learn the history. Can you tell us a little bit about the history?
Well, you know who started the riots is the Queens.
I never knew that this was like the historic place.
Okay, so you knew that there were Stonewall riots, but you really didn't know that there was this connection.
Oh, okay.
No, I didn't know. And then you were just walking down the street and you
and it was like, ta-da!
She's never been here and my friend has never been here, so we decided to take them to Stonewall.
So why Stonewall?
I've been coming here for like 2.5 years and my friend brought me for the first time and the atmosphere is just wonderful. Everyone
so your friend
gets
along. Your friend brought you here 2.5 years ago?
Yep.
How old are you?
I'll be 23 in about a month.
23 in a month. When is your birthday?
January 13th.
Aww.
I'm a baby.
Yeah, that's good. So you've been coming here for 2.5 years already. So yeah. At 19, you were already coming to Stonewall.
Should we cut that?
No, that's the, oh, I'm sorry. Never before the age of 21 was Kristen here. Where are you from?
Wisconsin.
Wisconsin?
I'm from Arena, Wisconsin.
I'm from Madison, Wisconsin.
And what are you guys doing here tonight?
What are we doing? Celebrating my birthday.
Happy birthday!
Thank you.
So what brought you to Stonewall as opposed to anywhere else in New York City?
We wanted to soak up the history.
What history?
You know the history.
I might not.
Movement. Yeah, I'm sure you do. Miss Pussytail.
It wasn't actually Christmas. It was 6 months prior. It was, what was that? June 28th, 1969. But before I get to that, I think what's really important is to like set the stage. Because if you don't know how the stage is set, how do you know what's going to be happening? After World War I, a lot of people who were LGBT took the opportunity, because of the number of people who were in the armed services, to relocate to big cities where, you know, they could blend in and be, you know, safety in numbers and all that stuff. And Harlem and the Village both, for about like 30, 40 years, were known as these places where the other people could go. And this subculture developed where men had women's hair and women had men's hair, and that was like really interesting and exotic. During the 1950s, there was this total douchebag in Congress who was like, oh my God, communism's like bad. Like, it's gonna come get you and your family and kill them. So, like, he was able to create this hysteria in the public.
Government can't control everything without controlling me. What I can say and what I can't say. And I mean police control that tells me where I'll work, where I'll live, and all the rest of it.
Just words. The people know what they want. Vote against the old, ruthless, sick American economy with its private property and its so-called free competitive enterprise. Vote for the master state with the master plan.
Our time is almost up, but tomorrow you'll be able to vote to keep what we have or to change for a total economy where everything will be run according to a master plan. For or against the master state under the master plan. Thank you and good night.
Well, what do you think?
I'm for it. I'm tired of being kicked around.
I think it sounds wonderful.
He said it would mean full employment. That's something.
Just think what that means.
Full security. Why shouldn't the government take care of us?
I'm afraid I don't understand it very well.
Well, the way I get it, everything will be planned. And the whole country will run according to the plan.
What's wrong with that? They talk about free enterprise. Private enterprise. I'm sick of listening to them. I'm going to vote for it.
Well, I am, that's for sure.
I guess I will, too.
And anyone might be a communist, and it was like a witch hunt. And like, it was sick. It was disgusting. It turned neighbors on neighbors and family on family. And people would say like, oh, I think this person might be a communist because they said X, Y, and Z.
I believe that 95% of the people in California are decent, honest American citizens. The Communist Party is a minority, but a dangerous minority. It is completely against the un-American feeling, this communistic thing. I believe I would move to the state of Texas if it ever came here, because I think the Texans would kill them on sight.
And in the 1950s, McCarthy actually like convinced the Congress to think that gay people could be accepting blackmail and could be bribed and would actually be a hazard to the state. So that's one of the reasons why, especially in the 50s and 60s, like rounding up gays and going to gay bars and harassing people became such a thing. If I'm gay, you might tell my wife or society or these other people who are gonna come get me. And so like you can blackmail me and say like, oh my God, don't tell my wife, here's $1,000. And because of that, like all of a sudden I'm gonna be sucking fucking like Stalin's dick. I heard he's hung. It was a really scary time, especially for people who were not white Anglo-Saxon Protestant men who are straight. If you weren't one of those things, you was fucked.
This moral decay weakens our resistance to the onslaught of the communist masters of deceit. He is even enticed to enter the world of homosexuals, lesbians, sadists, masochists, and other sex deviants. They tell youngsters that it's smart, it's thrilling, it provides kicks to be a homosexual, a sadist, and every other kind of deviant.
So something else that a lot of people don't know is that in old gay culture, they actually call before Stonewall the time before the windows open. So what does that mean? Well, because what I was saying before, like about McCarthyism and fear and that environment, a lot of people actually were not ready to be rounded up and like put in some kind of prison camp or have all their assets taken away or be humiliated in the media, like by that asshole McCarthy or something. So they, no, for serious. So they actually would go to places where they would soap the windows, you know, like some kind of like new store that's about to open, like, oh, coming soon. You know, they would like put soap and shit in the window to be like, you can't see through here. You know, but also, like, they would put anything, plywood, you know, in, like, an industrial area or big heavy drapes in, like, more of a residential area to be like, there's nothing going on here, nothing to see here, child, move on. And that's the reason, is that they did not feel like they wanted to be rounded up or arrested or harassed or bribed or extorted or any of that shit. So, in that time period, not only was there a lot of discontent among gay people, but obviously women and minorities and the civil rights movement was born in that time. And people were angry and they let their feelings be known.
Conditions of unlawful assembly exist under authority of section 726 of the California Penal Code, and in the name of the people of the state of California.
So by the time we get to the late 60s, all these other groups had started to, you know, kind of act out, but gay people still targeted.
What Jimmy didn't know is that Ralph was sick, a sickness that was not visible like smallpox, but no less dangerous and contagious. A sickness of the mind. You see, Ralph was a homosexual, a person who demands an intimate relationship with members of their own sex.
And there was this little place called the Stonewall in Greenwich Village, and it was one of many places, actually, where gay people would gather. And in this period of fear and discontent and upset, you know, people are just trying to also live their lives and do their thing. Now, a couple of things. Class is class in our country, and if you were rich, you were able to go to your closed-door, nice little manor house, like, gay-ass party, and be fine. You know, you could have your beard, who was some rich white lady, and be fine. But at that time, most people were not that fine. And so, like, what the Stonewall and places like it attracted were poor people who were disadvantaged and disempowered, a lot of minorities, a lot of people from poor backgrounds, people who were rejected, drag queens, transvestites, people who are transgender.
As far as I'm aware, it was pretty much the start of the gay rights movement when the drag queens and the trans people, who were not mentioned in that movie that came out, you know, just like, we're gonna take it anymore, when there was a raid on Stonewall.
And the movie sucked because it's not what happened. They whitewashed it.
Yeah, rich people had their own places to go. And sure, they would go to places like the Stonewall on occasion to be like, oh, I'm going to be, like, naughty. But, like, in reality, like, the people who went to Stonewall every day were the people who were, like, really on the outskirts of, like, acceptable society and really disenfranchised, disempowered, you know. What I have heard was that it was 98% male by birth. Actually, the bouncers at the time, because of the police presence and, like, all those lineups and all that stuff, they wouldn't allow very many people who were of one gender dressing as the other gender. Whether or not, there was no such thing as trans at the time. There was no such thing. So, like, it didn't matter. You know, if you were born with a penis, you are a boy. And why are you wearing women's clothes? If you're born with a vagina, you are a girl. Why are you wearing some men's clothes? You know, and that was an issue. Places like this actually got invaded by the police all the time, but at the time, it was all gel lights and black lights. And the only time that the incandescent or fluorescent lights were turned on was when the police came. Because, like, they needed that kind of separation between, like, what's cool and you can be yourself and what is, like, girl, get your shit and put your guard on, you know? I mean, it was serious. Like, McCarthyism wasn't like, I went to jail because I drank too much. It was like, you're, like, up for treason. Like, you could go to jail forever or die because of treason. That's, like, significant.
You have seen two types of communist-inspired violence, one taking the form of mass challenges of authority and defiance of law and order inside a congressional hearing room, the other coming in the form of open rioting and physical resistance to law enforcement. A third type of communist tactic, common in the Operation Abolition campaign, is defiance by individual witnesses and their attorneys to the committee itself.
This question has no purpose other than to harass me. When I was asked this question last in 1943 by the late Joe McCarthy, and let me say that I am honored when people come up to me on the street, perhaps they don't deserve this honor, and say, you're the man who killed Joe McCarthy. Because I happened to appear on the first day of the book burning hearing, and I did my best to conduct myself in the manner which I'm conducting myself today. If there were any such evidence against me under any law, the proper authorities could move against me. This body is improperly constituted. It is a kangaroo court. It does not have my respect. It has my utmost contempt. And I am not going to answer that question, sir.
One of the popular names for the police at the time was Betty Badge. And when the police would come through and try to get these places, what they would do would be they would kind of knock on the door, all the lights would turn on, and then the police would come in and everyone would have to form a line and produce their ID. Which is like, in 2015, you think, like, that's some fucked up shit. Like, I go out to the bar, I might have some fun at the club, but, like, why am I gonna have to, like, it's 1 a.m, the lights are on, and I have to stand in line and produce my ID, like, what the fuck, you know? But that's what life was like at the time, you know, because of this environment of McCarthyism and fear and all of that shit. And it was, like, pretty serious. So anyway, like, people would stand up and stand in line with their IDs, and if you were dressed in drag, by the way, for women too, if women didn't have 3 articles of traditionally feminine clothing, they were actually arrested. And if you were a man and you were dressed in girls' clothes, you were arrested.
This picture is not one typical of the physique magazines. It approaches another class of magazines dealing with transvestites, wherein the wearing of female garments is that which provides sex gratification for the participant. This picture, of course, merely confesses on the cover of the magazine the charges we have made.
One of the actual tricks that a lot of drag queens used at the time actually was to carry the draft card, because if you carried your draft card, it was something that a lot of people wouldn't fuck with, because in a lot of liberal enclaves at the time, a lot of people who, you know, were of drafting age were draft dodging. And in fact, like, I know of people who, you know, when they were called to the draft, would run away, or they would come dressed in women's clothing trying to evade the draft.
I don't know. It's, you just don't talk about it. It's like that elephant.
And you couldn't talk about it when you were in the armed forces.
No. Yeah, I was in the military. You couldn't talk about it. In fact, I got pulled into some office to be investigated because somebody told them I was in a gay bar. So, like,
can you imagine?
Oh my God, I was like, they were asking me all these questions about, are you gay? How long have you been? And where, how come you were with these women? What were you doing? We know that you were there, and I've denied it. Like, but it was crazy. For hours, they pulled all of us into an office.
The police activity was something that was ongoing, and it was very harassing. And so this, like, period and this, like, idea of, like, discontent and, like, standing up for your rights and, like, what you believe in and who you are became more and more a reality for different people. And then here comes the day that Judy Garland dies in 1969 in June.
We talked about The Wizard of Oz, and in The Wizard of Oz, basically, they had this land full of people that were smaller than everyone else, and Dorothy and everyone, and they were basically, in this land, it was okay for everyone to be kind of who they are, and in the flip side, in the real world, it was like kind of dark, and they always said that there were hidden LGBT messages in The Wizard of Oz, and
I want to rewatch The Wizard of Oz.
Dorothy and friends were actually all
homos?
Yeah.
Her death prompted a lot of energy behind, you know,
that she was like the original Cher.
She was. And, you know, they were out celebrating that night. They were out celebrating her life.
And people are out at the Stonewall having a good time, doing their party thing, and then all hell breaks loose when Betty Bad shows up the door, and the lights turn on, and they're having a hard time with some drag queens. And the drag queen said, you know what? That is enough, Tal. I have had enough. No, it's true. I have had enough. And they went outside with them popos and really, really, really just had it out.
The fact that many of them said, screw it. We're going to stay here and take us and do what you want and kick us and spray us and whatever you need to do. But we're not going away.
You know, and one thing that people don't know about the Stonewall is actually, it wasn't owned by the LGBT community, because in our culture, the most important thing is money. And so the people who owned it actually were the mafia. And like many places like this, it was mafia run. And, you know, when the police would come, the owners would just kind of like turn like a blind eye to like the police coming and like whatever. But this time, the people in the bar, not the bar management, not the bar owners, but the people in the bar said, that is enough. And they went outside and beat those fucking police up and turned over some cop cars and had their way with them. And it was something that became a thing. And for like a couple of nights in a row, these protesters came out in Greenwich Village and just like said, that's enough. That was actually the beginning of Pride. That like the next year in 1970, on June 28th, that was the first Pride parade. And that's why like New York always has its Pride parade at the end of June, in San Francisco and LA and all these other big cities that at the beginning all teamed up with the gay people and LGBT people in New York and said, that is enough. People actually came together and said, fuck you, we gay and we here. You know, and they would open bars and establishments without having all of these different protections. I mean, there was Compton's Cafeteria earlier in San Francisco, but that wasn't quite the same important political mix, you know, of discontent and media exposure and police in a very liberal neighborhood. And it just wasn't quite the same. It was Stonewall that really fortified and galvanized that gay movement, not only within the United States, but across the whole world. What were we going to talk about?
Polari.
Polari. So most people don't know what Polari is, and it's amazing because I'm 35 years old in 2015, and even people in their 50s these days don't even know what Polari is. And so it's so important to preserve this shit, bitch. And what Polari is the gay language. And before Stonewall, and before that time when the windows open, Polari was the main way that gay people, especially gay men, interact with each other in the world. And, like, you know, you think about our friend the Carnies, because everyone loves the Carnies. And, like, because the Carnies traveled from country to country and place to place, they had to have a language. And, like, around that time, like, the Latin language was dying, and all these vernacular tongues were rising. So people spoke a combination of French, Italian, and Spanish, and also some German, and also some English, and also some Russian. Because they had, like, interact with each other and, like, talk together, they created this language called Polari. Now, fast forward to 500 years ago. That's, like, not a fast forward, but whatever. And, like, you know, you think about, you know, when theater separated from being part of a carnival, and there's, like, the Globe Theater and other theaters that are, like, actual buildings as opposed to, like, just tents and shit. And so carnies and the theater people separated from each other. And the carnies continued to speak one language called Polare. And the theater people spoke Polari. And so it diverged. It's the same root language. But ultimately, you know, as you know, like, women weren't allowed to act because apparently everyone hated women until just recently. Because there were so many gay people, gay men, involved in the theater, Polari became the gay language. This language existed until after Stonewall, because after Stonewall, you didn't need that language anymore. So it's one of those things that's, like, a really great victory for the Stonewall era and the Stonewall riots, because all of a sudden, this, like, period of LGBT kind of, like, being closeted and very insular ended. But at the same time, like, that was the beginning of the end for gay culture and what it meant to be, like, an actual culture. Because, like, it's bizarre, but our culture worldwide was on the verge of having its own true language, like a dictionary language, which we never quite achieved, but almost.
Are there any words today that you know that are used either just, like, within the community that have persisted through or been preserved?
Carson King, Carson Kinley, and Queer Eye for the Straight Guy brought back the word zhuzh.
You can put some fresh flowers in here, you can put a bottle of wine, you can really just zhuzh it up.
That word is a Polari word. And another word that most people know from HIV treatment and HIV prevention, Truvada, actually means health and well-being. And so the pharmaceutical companies figured that these people would be familiar with Polari or understand it enough that they would really see it as, like, something that would be, like, kind of bringing back their cause. And ultimately, the sad fact is that most people from who were of that age in the 80s and 90s who didn't die because they were like, oh my God, this thing is terrible. I'm not going to touch anyone ever. Or I have to use, like, 12 condoms. And, like, you know, I mean, yeah, it's kind of a sad thing. So actually, most people today don't even have any idea what Polari is. Mm-hmm. Even people of that time frame don't know what Polari is because they grew up after the time that the windows opened and never had to deal with that bullshit, you know, with the McCarthyism and Betty Badge and lining up in a line and how many articles of clothing you'd be having and, like, all that kind of stuff that they had before.
And I think a lot of young people, especially in the gay community, almost take it for granted nowadays, not even really realizing what people did before us to get here. So thank you to them and to the Stonewall for paving the way for us, because it's made a lot easier for us to be who we are today.
That was the beauty of that moment at Stonewall, when everyone came together in the face of this adversity, not only of thousands of years of culture, but McCarthyism and police and, like, stuff that we couldn't even imagine today, you know, that, you know, you'll have to ask your parents about. Like, that is what Stonewall is about.
in a black man, we don't get the respect. Oh, we on the DL. That's my phone. Take my phone.
I know.
Like but every masculine black guy.
It's time for us to make love.
I know you have.
We gonna make love, but I still want the world to know. Black, gay, masculine men matter, and you need to know everybody is not on the DL. I'm not on the DL. I've been gay. I was born this way, but I'm a man first. God bless America. And fuck Trump.
Oh, you're so good.
But so gay in the Polari language is an actually seems like it's an acronym, and it means good as you.
Thank you.
Good, awesome. Good as you. Good as you.
Thank you, Christine.
It says good as you.
It's as good as you.
Good as you.
It's like when this video airs and I get fired from work for drinking.
You better make millions on this, because we're all fired.